Good morning and welcome everyone. We want to start and thank you for coming. I invite our host, Professor Tamar Dayan, who is the chair of this wonderful facility, the Museum of Natural. לא שומעים? עכשיו שומעים? Professor Tamar Dayan, the chair of the museum, Steinhardt Museum for Natural History. And I must tell you that when I asked her to use this auditorium for the meeting, I think that it took just a few minutes to get the request approved. And I think that we all have to thank her for her kind help. Thank you, Tamar.
Good morning, everyone, and it's good to have you all here today celebrating Ilan Golani's birthday and many years of great contribution to science. And of course, I'm very thrilled that all this is happening at the Steinhardt Museum. Now, as you know, I'm not an expert in animal behavior, but I did do all my graduate studies at the department, or now School of Zoology, at the zoo. And the zoo at the time was Mendelssohn, Yoram, and Ilan. And I took Ilan's animal behavior course, and I was surrounded by Ilan's graduate students. I think, Ilan, it was the first cohort of your students with Ilana Ganor and David Eilam and Gil Bronsti, who returned to France, and Anat Bialy and Yona Yaniv, who are now both medical doctors, all excellent graduate students discussing the structure of behavior from rats to human babies, movement and exploration. And I can't say that I understood everything, I still don't, but the group had the atmosphere of something new and different and exciting in science, and I was drawn to it. The notion that behavior could be a structure, that this structure could be mapped, that one could talk about homologies and the evolution of behavior and their implications for the mammalian brain sounded innovative and exciting. It took me years to understand a little bit of the huge potential of the budding research agenda. I probably still don't understand most of it, but when I look at Ilan's scientific record of publications, I see the same terms, the structure of behavior, exploratory behavior, locomotor behavior, in the best publication venues, PNAS and Nature Methods, behavioral brain research, and scientific reports, all relating to timely and exciting scientific questions. And I know that, yes, something truly innovative and exciting was happening there, and clearly it still is, and that Ilan continues to lead a path-breaking research program. So I'm sure that you'll all have an exciting day of science, and I wish you, Ilan, a very happy birthday and many coming years where you will continue to be as productive and exciting in your research output. Mazal tov.
Now, Professor Noga Kronfeld-Shor, the head of the School of Zoology, will welcome us.
Good morning, everyone. On behalf of the School of Zoology, I welcome you to this symposium celebrating Ilan's 80th birthday. Mazal tov, Ilan. I came a little bit later, so I was Tamar's first PhD student, but Yoram was still at the zoo and I was working with Professor Amiram Shkolnik. Ilan is a part of the generation who actually formed the department, now School of Zoology, and he influenced its DNA until today, not only because he's still working, actively working at the zoo at 80 years old, having students and projects and grants, but also in his spirit, and we had some interesting discussions about my work too. And on a more personal note, I think he also had an influence on the general public. I remember as a primary school child, I was watching the Televisia Chinuchit, and it was the first I saw Ilan explaining about whales and about esulas and chimpanzees, and it was the first time I heard the word ethology. And I started looking and reading Conrad Lorenz books after I saw this TV show. So it really influenced my personal interests, and I'm sure that also other children who saw these TV shows. And I looked on Google on Saturday, and I could find the actual original TV show, and I want to show you just the first 2 minutes, because I was really excited by it. לא שומעים קצת, להגדיר את זה?
זה מגדיר? כן.
שאלה שנייה, מה התפקוד? שבדרך כלל נוהגים לחלק את ההתנהגות, תפקודים ביולוגיים בסיסיים, גידול צאצאים, הזדווגות, בניית קן, שמירה על הפרווה, סירוק של נוצות, וכל תפקודים ביולוגיים בסיסיים שבעל החיים לא יכול להתקיים בלעדיהם. וכל הסרטים שראינו, ראינו פתאום שני בעלי חיים נעמדים זה מול זה, ועושים שורה שלמה של התנהגויות מוזרות, שאין להם תפקוד ביולוגי בסיסי נראה לחיים. והאתולוגים נוהגים להסביר התופעה הזאת בכך שיש מכלול שלם של התנהגויות שנותקו מההקשר הבסיסי הזה והן משמשות למה שקוראים תקשורת. למשל, התינוק של בבול.
You're all welcome to search הטלוויזיה החינוכית אילן גולני, and this will come up, and there are really nice movies and explanations. I watched it several times on Saturday, kept going to it again and again. It was really exciting. So, mazal tov, Ilan, and have a good symposium. Thank you.
Okay, so in the first half of the 20th century, zoologists over the world started to study the behavior of various animals. And these studies then led to the conception of a new field of research, ethology. Probably the most significant point in this field was in October 73, when three ethologists, distinguished ethologists, received the Nobel Prize in medicine and physiology, the only ethologist ever since that received this prize. And in the manifest of the Karolinska Institute, they wrote, "They are the most eminent founders of a new science called the comparative study of behavior or ethology." Surprisingly, when you look at what Lorenz and Tinbergen, two of the laureates of the prize, say or describe or consider their field of research, they didn't consider it as a new science, but a sort of extension or derivative of physiology, or the way that Ilan likes to say it, extension of anatomy. The reasons for this were probably that, first of all, the high standing of physiology at that time, which was the glorious and celebrated field in biology at that time. And the second thing was that they wanted to anchor their studies in biology and not in psychology, that was popular and gaining ground at this time in the States as experimental psychology. At the same time, in Israel, first in Yehuda Halevi 12, the first location of the zoo, and then in Abu Kabir, and then in the current place, if you recognize, this is the current location of the zoo, this, the construction of the current location of the zoo. This is the building. These are the constructions of the reptile yard. and you can see how old it is. It is all empty at that time. Another thing occurred, a parallel world, when Ilan Golani and perhaps also Amod Zehavi brought ethology to Israel. And via the very thorough familiarization with the leaders of the field in the world, and even more important, with the studies, they introduced to Israel the field of ethology. I also searched for the educational TV in Israel for movies with Ilan, again, one that I remember that I saw already as a student, and let's see it.
שצילמנו בגן הזואולוגי של האוניברסיטה, של אוניברסיטת תל אביב, שמדגימים את אותה תופעה עצמה של התנהגות על ריק.
חזק מדי?
כאן אנחנו רואים שחף, ציפור ימית, מתרחץ בתוך גיגית, טובל את הראש שלו בתוך המים, מבדר את הנוצות ומחדיר את המים פנימה, מיד הוא יפרוס גם את הכנפיים שלו, ויחדיר את המים מתחת לכנפיים. התנהגות טיפוסית של מחצה, אחר כך בדרך כלל הוא מסתרק, הנה פה הוא מסרק את המוצות. מה עושה שחף על יבשה כשאין מים? בדיוק את אותו הדבר על ריק. פה אמנם הוא עושה את זה מול מים, אבל אותו שחף יכול לבצע את זה בשטח שאין בו בכלל מים. הנה הניעור של הנוצות, שוב התרחצות, המים שאינם נשפכים כעת על כל הגוף כביכול, כן, עם הנוצות, פריסה של הזנב, הפמנה של הראש במים שאינם למעשה, את הראש אפילו לא מכניס את הראש מתוך הזרזיף. ניעור של המים שאינם והסתרקות. פה אנחנו רואים את בוני, בוני שועלת מדבר שנולדה וגדלה אצלנו בגן הזואולוגי. היא מקבלת פה ביצה, וכמו כל שועל בריא בגופו ובנפשו, לא אוכלת אותה, אלא מחפשת מקום להטמין אותו באדמה. הנה פה היא מצאה מקום, מחזיקה את הביצה מאוד בעדינות, שלא תשבר, יש לה שיניים חדות. מבצעת תנועות חפירה עם הרגליים הקדמיות. לוחצת על הביצה עם החותם. מבצעת תנועות כיסוי. ומהדקת את האפר. תנועת בידוק. זאת דוגמה של התנהגות אינסטינקטיבית, טבעית. שמתבצעת לא על ריק, אלא בהקשר הטבעי. עכשיו, מה קורה כאשר בניסוי אנחנו מרחיקים את החול מתוך הכלוב, ובוני נמצאת בכלוב שכולו רצפת בטון. ויכול התנהגות חיפוש. קופצת על דלת הכלוב שמובילה לחצר. הביצה הזאת מאוד שבירה. ולקפוץ ולהתרוצץ לא לשבור אותה זה לא כל כך פשוט. הנה פה נמצא המקום, תנועות של חפירה. הבור נחפר, שמים את הביצה בתוך הבור, נחוסת על הביצה עם החותם. עכשיו כיסוי.
עושה את פעולת ההתכנה, היא יכולה להתקדם.
זה לא גומי.
So you could see from the description that Ilan gave to this, the sharp eye and the sensitive eye to the behavior, to the very small details of behavior, and this is a prerequisite to study and to really understand animal behavior. And I like always to use this citation of Sherlock Holmes. It allows us to find things that others have not noticed. And in many cases in the world, when I met scientists and told them that I'm a student of Ilan Golani, they say, it's amazing. We read these papers and we realize that we saw these things all the time. It was in front of our eyes and we never noticed it until we read his papers. Back to Lorenz and Tinbergen. Their contribution to ethology is well known. It doesn't need any further explanations, but there was one thing that they didn't give or award this field or equip this field with, and I think that the field still suffers from it until today, and this is a reliable and good method to study behavior. And until now, ethology is a soft science. And into this gap, Ilan Golani brought an ingenious method, which is the application of the movement notation to study behavior. This paper, Ilan, when I was your student, you say that you are most proud of this paper, that you wrote it without any compromise. I think that it is really like that, and I think that it's a pain that many people that now work with automated methods do not go and try to see how they can use it for their methods. Now, let's see what this paper delivered and explained. That we can study motor behavior in relation to the animal's own body, in relation to the environment, in relation to a partner, and in relation to the topography contact point with the partner on the animal's own body. Nobody before that could imagine even to measure all these things simultaneously. And Ilan came with this, and I remember that I met a Dutch scientist who said, he is ahead of time, people do not understand yet what we can do with this method. In the Dictionary of Ethology, this is the way that they describe it. The Eshkol-Wachmann movement notation, originally devised for ballet, has brought refinement and precision to the description of animal motor patterns, including complex stylized interactions between two animals. And this was the time that I became a student of Ilan, and I was privileged to do this study with him. We will hear about it later on today. The study of the ontogeny, the mobility gradient in here, and this way that it looked like, to see it and to have pages and pages and pages like that notated frame after frame in the behavior of red pups. And it was amazing. I don't think that anyone is doing this kind of work anymore. At the same time, without functional, mechanistic, adaptive explanations and interpretation, behavioral studies are purely descriptive. And for this reason, ethology lost its independent status and gradually melted into other streams of biology. Wilson said that ecology and neuroethology were suggested as, or he suggested that they are more important than strictly behavioral research. And about that time, the field of sociobiology was catching ground, and the picture was said for ethology. That's what Barlow, one of the important ethologists in the post-Lorenz era, said that in 1989, ethology was declared dead, quiescent. It's unbelievable. And he thought that sociobiology is going to revive or revitalize ethology. It didn't happen, and I guess that the same thing that happened to ethology later happened to sociobiology, and behavioral ecology took over. The problem with ethology is that it diverged to too many fields. I guess that there are even more fields than of research that I depicted here in this slide. And for this reason, I think that ethology lost its standing as a new science as described in the Nobel Prize description. Even worse than this, in this book about the evolutionary thought in psychology, Henry Plotkin writes, "The simple truth is that ethology never did deliver as a science of comparative behavior." I think that saying that, he never read or understood Ilan's work, and I'm sure that by the end of the day, when you will hear Ilan's lecture, you will see that ethology did deliver it, it's just that people do not care that much about that. Ilan, this is from Google last night, and you are still picking with citations, and these are your most significant papers, most cited papers, and you can see that the homeostasis is still the third in the list, the one paper that you wrote without any compromise, and you thought that it is the most important, which I also think that it is like that. So people still believe in this and read it and care for it. And let me finish with a story in the 80s, I don't remember exactly when, John Fentress, who was at one point he was the president of the Animal Behavior Society, visited us in Tel Aviv, and he was sitting with me and looking at my work, and then with Yona Yaniv sitting and looking at her work, and then he came to you, Ilan, and said that he is happy to see that ethology is still alive in Tel Aviv. John Fentress died before 2-3 years, and I guess that if he would come to Tel Aviv now and look at the studies that are conducted in Tel Aviv, he would say the same thing, that ethology is still alive in Tel Aviv. Okay, Ilan, now the stage is yours, and you are welcome to come and to invite the speakers.